Hello everyone, this is Sarabjit Kaur and today we will start our chapter number 7 of novel, that is the revolution in France. So many years had passed since Lucy and Charles married. In the chapter number 6 you have learnt about that Lucy and Charles got married and many years now passed and they have one daughter. Now they had a daughter, little Lucy. Her name is little Lucy, who was the apple of their eye. That means she was the favorite one, apple of I, that my, I means who was the favorite one. So little Lucy was the apple of their eyes and darling of all the faithful visitors, the person who come to their home. All the visitors, she was the favorite of them also. Nothing gave them more pleasure than the sound of her little feet running to them and her innocent laughter. So, whenever she come to their parents, go here and there, whenever she laughs, that was the very pleasant moment for them. So, Sydney Carton was their least frequent visitor. So, Sydney Carton, who was also one of person who want to marry with the Lucy, she was the frequent visitor, yet he came regularly about 6 times a year and visited quietly with them. Little Lucy was very fond of Sydney Carton. She always plays with him. He has a very rough skin, but she likes to play with him. He was the first stranger to whom she held out her plump little arms to be lifted up the hilt. Now the next one stanzas. It was late one night in mid-July of year 1789. We are talking about 1789. It was a mid-July, round about little Lucy's 6th birthday. So it was 6th birthday of Lucy. Mr. Lorry arrived from Tellson's bank and sat with Charles and Lucy in the dark window looking out onto the large plane tree in the garden. The old gentleman was visibly preoccupied. So things are bad in Paris, very bad. Our French customers are sending us as much of their money as they can. That is not a good sign. You have no idea, dear Charles. Now Mr. Lorry and Charles both are discussing with each other that the conditions in the France that are not good. The things are going very worse there and it is not a good sign, they both discussed. So Charles said that we have no any idea that what is going over there. The same morning, July 14th, the district of Saint Antoine in Paris was like a boiling pot ready to overflow. It was as if a mass of scarecrows had come out into the streets carrying knives, sticks, guns, anything that could kill or injure. Defarge himself was the head of leading them. So it was July 14th in the Paris. It was like a boiling pot. Boiling pot, we are saying that is why, because there was a revolution in Paris that was ready to overflow. So many that if it was as if a mass of scarecrows, mass means majority of the people, scarecrows that is an instrument that we use, had come out of the streets like a scarecrows like knives, sticks, guns, etc. Anything that could kill or injure Defarge. Who was the head of the revolution? That was a Defarge, Mr. Defarge. Here you can see the picture. That revolution was there. Here is a Defarge and it is a Madame Defarge, who is the wife of Mr. Defarge. So, keep near Jacks 3, Jacks 2 and Jacks 1. Jacks that represents peasants. There is so many Jacks in here, chapter in your novel. You have seen in the first page, you can see that Jacks 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that means those who belong with the peasant class. They were also spotting to the Defarge family. Defarge family was leading to them, the peasant class. So, two and Jacks, one, put yourself at the head of these patriots. Where is my wife now? What was the name of that person? Defarge, he said that we have to come together, and he also asked that where is my wife, Mr. Madame Defarge appeared in the doorway of the cafe, an axe in one hand and pistol and a long knife tied in a belt around her hair. You can see again that it is Miss Madame Defarge. She is also carrying many weapons along with her. So her expression was always cold and determined. Seeing his wife, Defarge waved to the rest of the party. Now both are very energetic for the revolution. Come then, patriots and friends, we are ready to the Bastille. The roaring sea of people swinging their weapons in the air, beating drums, ringing bells, pushed forward an unstoppable angry mass. When they reached the hated Bastille, the prison guard fired their guns and cannons at them, but the roaring tidal wave of humanity stormed on the Defarge's command. So many people were there who were doing the revolution. So that mass was there, and they were going to the fort of Bastille. They are going towards that path, that place. So work, comrades, work, work. Jacks 1, Jacks 2, Jacks 1002, in the name of people, work. So here so many Jacks, that is a mass of peasants. He is commanding them, Mr. Defarge. Not far from Defarge, his family, heading a wild group of women, charged the wooden door that led into the prison with axes and hammers. The raging mob soon smashed a hole in the door big enough for a man to get through. So Madame Defarge is also very energetic, and she is doing her best in the revolution. So soon a white flag arose. The prison guards had surrendered. Shrieks were heard everywhere. Now there was a guards in the Bastille fort. They surrendered that they can't do anything now, and they arose a white flag. They arose the white flag. That means now they have surrendered. Shrieks were heard everywhere. Shrieks means cries. Now the prisoners, the records, the secret cells, the instruments of the torture. Defarge was making his way up to stone stairs as he is telling all the things that he want to do. Now he made his way stone stair as prison officer was making their way down. So when he was going upstairs, the officer was coming down terrified that the bloody thirsty crowd would tear them to pieces. So he was worried, he was very terrified, the officer, because he knows that that mass, the people will tear him. Defarge grabbed one by the neck and pulled him to the side. Now Defarge take him and grabbed one off by the neck and pulled by one side. Show me the north tower now. Yes, yes, cried the officer, shaking with fear. Now he said that tell me where is the north tower, and he was also trembling with the fear, and he said yes, yes, yes. Officer said to Defarge, Jacks 3 was screaming. Now Jacks 3, that is a peasant one who was screaming, kill him, kill him. What they said that, kill him, to the officer. What is the meaning of 105 north tower, said Defarge to the trembling officer. Now he is asking about the 105 north tower. Is it a prisoner or cell? Now he is asking the meaning of that one thing. He said that it is a prisoner or a cell. Now, a cell, sir, a cell, take me there. Now he said that that part is a cell. Now Defarge said that take me there, I want to go over there. The prisoner officer led them to the stone steps to the top of the towers, and with a large key opened a door which led to in the empty cell. A straw bed lay one while there was a stool and table against another. High up near the ceiling was a narrow window. Defarge turned to Jacks 3, search everywhere. Now the person went over there in the cell and they opened the door. There was an empty cell, and there was also a narrow door. Defarge turned to Jacks 3. Defarge tell to the Jacks 3 that search everywhere. As Jacks 3 was shining a light around the walls, Defarge cried, stop there. Look, Jacks A. M. Alexander Manette. And here he wrote a poor physician. So they found Alexander Manette. That was a doctor, Manette, whose daughter was Lucy. The two men tore the straw from the bed and searched everywhere. They broke the worn out furniture and even groped through the ashes left by the long dead fire before leaving. They set fire to everything that would burn. So in the cell, whenever they found the Mr. Bennett, then Dr. Bennett, then they set fire over there and burn all the things over there. Down in the bloody streets, the only calm soul in the screaming mob was Madame Defarge. There was only one calm lady, that was a Madame Defarge. She was holding a knife to the throat of a terrified officer. Now, officer is in the hands of Madame Defarge. When she saw her husband, she spoke at the last word the officer would ever hear. When her husband came, the officer spoke only last one, only listened last one words. Afterwards, she killed him. Look, here comes my husband, Jax. She plunged the knife in the officer's neck. As the blood gushed from the neck, she proclaimed, "Now you are paying for all the pain you have caused." Now she killed him. And she said that you have to pay for all the things by which people have suffered. Soon after, the starving mob began hanging guards from the lamppost in the frightening display of public contempt. The scarecrow of the Paris danced around the swinging bodies like merrymakers at the summer festival. Lamppost means street light. Contempt means respect. So they were very merry, they were very happy by all these things that they have won over the Bastille, fought, and they got the Mr. Bennett, Dr. Bennett. It was exactly 14 years after the barrel of wine had fallen off in the cart outside the Fars Cafe and someone had scribbled blood on the wall. So scribbled means written, that one particular person has written something on the wall with blood over there. Not long after these events, Jacks 5, the workman, was resting by the fountain in the village of the murder Mercus when another Jacks joined him. "How are things, Jacks?" asked the workman. Now, Jacks 5 was discussing with one of the Jacks, and they are discussing that how are things, Jacks? Asked the workman, asked about this thing. "Bad. No dinner today." Then they discussed about the dinner. He said that only supper will be there. These type of discussions was going over there. And afterwards, by August 1792, the French aristocracy fleeing for their lives had scattered far and wide. One hot afternoon of the same year, Mr. Lorry sat at his desk and Charles Darnay stood leaning on it, talking with him in low voice. Now, in the 1792, there is a time when they were, Charles and Mr. Lorry were again sitting, and they were discussing something in a low voice. "I have to go to Paris, Charles." Now, but Mr. Lorry said that he has to go to Paris. Charles was deeply concerned, but Charles was also deeply concerned. He was worried for him. "But to travel to France now, the weather is terrible, the journey long, the means of traveling uncertain, the country disorganized, and city is not safe." Because there was a revolution in France, so he said that it is not safe to go over there in this time. "My dear Charles, I must go. Who is going to bother an old man like me?" Then Mr. Lorry said that I am old enough, no one will be worried about myself, that who will bother about myself, that I am going over there. As to the disorganization, that is precisely why Tellson need to send someone like me. I know Paris well and speak the language. Our customers are depending on us. As to the uncertain traveling, I am prepared to go through a few inconveniences for the sake of Tellson. He said that I have to go for the sake of Tellson. "Are you leaving tonight then?" Charles asked that you are going to leave today. "Tonight I am. I intend to take Jerry with me." He said that I will take Jerry with myself. "He has been my bodyguard on Sunday night for so many years. Nobody in France will suspect him to be anything more than an English bulldog looking after his master." He said that Jerry as a bait dog. "I must tell you that I admire your gallantry and youthfulness, Mr. Lorry." Now he said that I would like to appreciate your bravery. Gallantry means bravery. Yeah, brave enough. Nonsense, perhaps. When I return, I will accept Telson's proposal to retire and live the rest of life my at ease. He said that I will postpone all the, I will leave all the things whenever I will come back and live my whole life in peace afterwards. Just then a bank representative brought over a letter and laid it on Mr. Lorry's desk. Afterwards, then a bank representative came and he brought a letter. And he kept that letter on Mr. Lorry's desk. Have you discovered any traces of this person, Mr. Lorry? He kept one letter over there. To whom they are going to give? He asked about that. Do you know about this one person? Mr. Lorry, Charles saw that it was addressed to him because Charles was the Marquis Evermont. He was from the very wealthy family, Charles was. And that letter was given for the Evermont. Now he is living in over there as a Charles, that he is very supportive to the poor people. But because he belongs to a very rich family, that is why people hate him, because their family background was very bad. So this letter was for the Marquis of the St. Evermont. No one except Dr. Manette knew that this was his real name. Only Dr. Manette was there who knows that it was the real name of the Charles. He had made Charles promise to the morning of his wedding not to reveal it to anyone. Dr. Manette promised to him with Charles that he will not reveal about his identity to anyone. So Mr. Lorry looked at the recipient's name on the letter. No, I have asked everyone here and no one can tell me where this gentleman is to be found. He said that I have asked to all, but no one knows that who is this person and where can we found that one person. Mr. Lorry noticed that several French gentlemen were at Telson's on business. He got up and approached them to inquire about mysterious Marquis. Now Mr. Lorry want to know about who is that one, and he went to inquire about this mysterious person. No one seemed able to shed any light though. At that moment, Mr. Striver, who happened to accompany French customers, saw the letter and to whom it was addressed. They are asking about the person who is, to whom it is addressed. Isn't that the nephew of Marquis who was murdered? They are asking about it is, maybe it will be the nephew of the Marquis who was murdered. Apparently the fellow just got up and left all the property to his mob. Very irresponsible, they say. He disagreed with the Marquis and sympathized with the people. Terrible fellow. Charles decided he had to speak. Now Charles knows that this letter is for him because he is Evermont. So he decided to speak. I know the fellow. Striver looked at him in surprise. He said that I know who is that one person. He looked at him in a surprise. Do you? Oh, I am sorry to hear it. Why, Mr. Darnay, do you need to ask why? But I do ask why. Because he has given in to the peasants, that's why. Careful not to reveal his secret, but greatly distressed, Charles ended the discussion quickly. By hook and crook, he escaped himself and he said that he knows about the person. I think you may not understand the fellow, Mr. Striver. Mr. Lorry asked Charles if he could. Then Mr. Lorry said that deliver this letter to that particular person. He said that he will do. Charles agreed and took the letter. As soon as he had left the bank, he tore the letter open and read it, and it reads as follow. So there was a letter that was from the Gabelle, the prison of Abbaye, Paris, from where the letter came. That was from the prison of Abbaye, that was in Paris. It was written on June 21st, 1792. So it was for the Charles, whose name was also Dear Monsieur Lee Marquis. My life is in danger and my house has been burnt to the ground. The crime for which I am excused, having helped and served you, is treason against the people. He said that I am in prison, that why they have excused me, why they have arrested me, that I have helped and served you to the Marquis. I having been tired, tried to explain that I have acted for the people according to their commands, that I have collected no tax, note and returned to money they had paid in the past. So he said that my fault is that I was helping the poor people, because Charles was a very good person and his family background was very worse. They were very rich and famous person, but they always collect taxes from the poor people. They were doing very much bad things with them. I have in vain tried to explain that I have acted for the people according to your commands, that I have collected no tax. They had paid in the past. The only response of the tribunal is that I have acted for an emigrant. And where is that emigrant? Now, the thing is that he is excused for the thing that he is working for a emigrant. Emigrant, the person who leaves country. And went over in any other country. That is an emigrant. That emigrant, that he was helping to an emigrant, that emigrant was the Charles. So that is why he was arrested. My dear sir, I once risked my life to help you leave the country. I desperately need your help now. I was true to your to you, Marquis Lee Monsieur Lee Marquis. I pray you will be true to me, your servant, Babele. Now, he was the servant of Charles. He said that I have tried to do my best. I serve the poor people, but now my life is in danger. I am unsafe, so please help me. As soon as Charles read the letter, he knew that he had to go to Paris. Now, Charles knew that he had to return to the Paris, but he could tell no one. He was unable to tell to anyone. Only Dr. Manette was the option to whom he can tell everything. However, he needed to let people Gabelle know of his forthcoming arrival, and so he returned to the bank in evening to see Mr. Lorioff. I have delivered the letter. Now he went to Mr. Lorry that he has given the letter to that particular person. Then he said, well done, could you give the sender an oral response? Now he said that, can you give that response to the, because he have to give the response to the Gabella also, Gabelle also. That is why he said to Mr. Lorry, can you give the response to over there? Willingly, if it is not dangerous, whom shall I see? A man called Gabelle, a prisoner in the Abbaye, Paris. Mr. Lorry looked somewhat puzzled. What shall I tell him? Then he said that, what should I do? What can I say over there? Just tell him that Marquis is on his way. So he decided to go over there. He said that to Mr. Lorry that give my message to Gabelle that I am on the way. He said this is in the form that Marquis is on the way. When will the Marquis get there? Tell him that he is leaving tomorrow night. He said that when he will went over there, he said that he will leave that tomorrow night. So the night Charles wrote two letters, one to his wife explaining why he had to go to Paris and the other to Dr. Manette asking him look after his wife. So this is a letter. You can see Charles Darnay decided to go to the Paris now. He is going. The day of his departure was very hard for Charles. Unaware of her husband's plans, Lucy was particularly happy that day, but he could not allow her affectionate mood to keep him from his mission. He had the duty to Gabelle. So he tell everything to his to Dr. Manette, and he said that he wrote that one letter to Dr. Manette on that day and one to his wife. That night was very hard for him, and half an hour before midnight, Charles left the letter on the hall table of his Soho home, quietly closed the door and went to the nearest stable where he had arranged to pick up horse that would take him to Dover. His dangerous journey had begun. He tried to put out his mind to that thought he might never see his wife and daughter again. Now he decided to go to Paris, and he knows that it will be very dangerous journey, and he took a horse from the Dover, and his dangerous journey was started, and he thought that he will never see his wife and daughter after it. This is all about chapter number 7. If there will be any doubt, you can ask in the comment section box. Next, we will continue in the chapter number 8. And in this chapter, there will be internal questions also, because in the exams, internal questions can be asked also. So prepare those ones. and do your exercises from the novel book, and what do you discuss the following question, everything which is on the back side you have to solve and write the word meanings of these chapters also. Thanks and have a nice day.